Amos, from the book of Amos, chapter 5, verses 6 and 7, and then 10 through 15. Listen to the words from Amos. Seek the Lord and live, or he will break out against the house of Joseph like fire, and it will devour Bethel with no quenching. Ah, you that turn justice to wormwood and bring righteousness to ground, they hate the one who proves in the gate, and they abhor the one who speaks the truth. Therefore, because you trample on the poor and take from them levies of grain, you have built houses of human stone, but you shall not live in them. You have planted pleasant vineyards, but you shall not drink their wine. For I know how many are your transgressions and how great are your sins. You who afflict the righteous, who take a bribe and push aside the needy in the gate. Therefore, the prudent will keep silent in such a time, for it is an evil time. Seek good and not evil, that you may live. And so the Lord, the God of hosts, will be with you, just as you have said. Hate evil and love good, and establish justice in the gate. It may be that the Lord, the God of hosts, will be gracious to the remnant of Joseph.
Jesus, only Savior,
who loves us just the way we are, but loves us too much to let us stay that way. Will you pray with me? May the words of my mouth and the meditation in our hearts and minds be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, for you are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Scriptures that I chose this morning do come from the Common Lectionary. And in those scriptures, when you really go in and look at them, there's a lot of similarity of what is being taught there. Our character and how we react to the wealthy and the poor, one of the things. In Amos 5, verse 12, God puts so much emphasis on how we treat the needy and how we treat the rich of those of equal station often reflects what we hope to get from them. But because the poor can give us nothing, how we treat them reflects on our true character. Hear the words from Amos 5, 12 again, for I know how many are your transgressions and how great are your sins. You who afflict the righteous, who take a bribe and push aside the needy at the gate. Well, what does this say? According to my Bible commentary, it points out how many excuses we hear all the time for not helping the poor and needy. Number one, they don't deserve help. Number two, they got themselves into poverty and let them get themselves out. God's call to help the poor is not for this time. That's another time. Any money I give will be wasted or spent on something that's not worth anything anyway. And the list can go on, and I'm sure that all of you have heard many of these things. But why was Amos chastising God's chosen people? Because Amos lived down in Judah, and God sent him to the northern boundary, which was Israel. And so he's talking to the Israelites. It seemed like my term would be the Israelites fell off the wagon once again. They just got kind of fat and sassy. They were prosperous. They started to sell their own family members into slavery. Anything to be rich and comfortable and not have any responsibility to anyone other than themselves. When in Amos in verse 10, they hate the one who reproves in the gate, and they abhor the one who speaks the truth. At that time, the judge was stood in the gate, and at the city gate is where the punishments or justice was administered. At the city gate. They didn't come into a courtroom or anything like that. It was done at the city gate. We know society is in trouble when those who try to do right are hated for their justice. Any society that exploits the poor and defenseless or hates the truth is bent on destroying itself. Right now, our society may be, or at least is on the verge, of a crisis with all sorts of drugs. We live in a society where our medical profession seems to have a pill for everything. Pardon me. And if that pill upsets you, they've got a pill to take care of that too. I get up early in the morning and watch early news, which is probably not the best way to start your day. Seems to me that there must be a lot of older people get up early because most of the commercials are sponsored by pharmaceutical companies. I watch those happy people taking their happy pills or puffing on their happy inhalers. Seems there's always happy background music. And I have to wonder why my pills and my inhalers don't work like theirs do, because everybody's happy. Mine doesn't work that way. But forgive me, I digress. But it seems like there is a little bit of a connection between society and society today. And here's where I see the connection. I think back to the last couple of drives that this church has had, and I'll specify the drive to, for Weave, and the drive for the food bank. And this church, you people, are light years ahead of what the Israelites were doing way back then. Because you do share, you do take your responsibility to other people in the community very seriously. We truly live our faith in this church. And we don't need Amos to come calling for, you know, I can say it very simply, for a bunch of Gentiles, we don't do too bad. Let's move forward to our readings from Mark. Again, we find the love of money and worldly possessions being a barrier to a young man. The young man asked Jesus what he must do to be able to inherit eternal life. And of course, Jesus tells him, he has to keep the commandments. Well, he said, I've done that for him, because I've been doing that since I was a kid. But then Jesus drops the bombshell and tells him he must go sell all of his worldly possessions and take money and give it to the poor. And of course, the young man walked away sad, grieving, because he, like many of us, find those possessions very important, and we don't want to give them up. What does he have to do to inherit eternal life? But then Jesus went on and told the disciples how hard it will be for a person of wealth to enter the kingdom of God. The disciples were astonished, seeing they felt that wealth was a blessing from God, a reward for being good. Well, this misconception is still true today. Many believers enjoy material prosperity, while many others live in hardship. Wealth is not a sign of faith or partiality on God's part. But did Jesus really mean, I have to give up my big screen TV, or I have to watch four different things at the same time? I don't think that's the point at all. To me, the point is simply this. It's reminding us that we need to keep our lives in proper order and put my big screen TV in the proper place where it belongs. Not here between me and my Lord and Savior. It has to be somewhere down the line. If I remove, or we remove, all those barriers in our lives, we can serve him fully. We put our worldly possessions and money in the proper places, and Jesus first in our lives. Everything else will find its place. Remember how Jesus responded to the young man. The scripture tells that Jesus spoke lovingly. He showed genuine love for this man, even though Jesus knew the man might not follow him and probably wouldn't. The important point, I think, to get from this particular section is love is able to give tough advice. All of you, parents, have gone through that very thing. I hesitate to, I won't go into it in the diatribe of the tests I put my parents to, but I can guarantee you that I put them to some tests. But there was tough love. Christ loved us enough, crying out, to go die for us on the cross. And he loves us enough then to talk straight to us. And that's exactly what he's doing here in Mark 10. Jesus said it was very difficult for the rich to enter the kingdom of God, because the rich, with most of their basic needs met, became self-reliant. If they felt empty, they could go buy something to dull the pain. This feeling is the very same thing as Amos spoke of to the Israelites 700 and some years before. Israelites were fat and sassy, But there were rich people at that time. There are rich people in Jesus' time, but there are rich people in our time. I guess one way of considering that is things haven't changed a whole lot over the years, have they? It's still sort of the same. But Jesus explained it this way to his followers, and I just love this part of it. In the world to come, the values will be reversed. Those who seek status here on earth will have none in heaven. And those who are humble here will be great in heaven. The corrupt condition of our society encourages confusion in values. We are constantly bombarded by messages that tell us how to be important and how to feel good. In this light, when we think of this constant bombardment, then we take Jesus' teaching, boy, they seem a little strange, a little alien to us, because that doesn't work in today's society, is sort of what we're being told time after time after time. But those who humbly served others are most qualified to be great in heaven. As I stand here this morning humbly before you, my friends, I see many humble servants seated in this church. Now, I've been involved with this church for nearly 20 years, and I have never, ever seen this church or this congregation back down from any challenge that was placed in front of them. This church, in my life, and you folks, have no barriers. I see love, I see compassion, and caring. And my friends, in my life, it don't get any better than that. Thanks be to God. Amen.